Since hydroxide is a terrible leaving group, we have to convert alcohols into good leaving groups by one of a few methods. And so one of the things we've already looked at in a separate video are reactions in acidic conditions for substitutions and eliminations of alcohols. Well, let's look at more controllable basic conditions with the following reagents: phosphorus trichloride, phosphorus tribromide, thionyl chloride, tosyl chloride, or another sulfonyl chloride. Plenty of these reagents exist, and phosphorus oxychloride in basic conditions. We say basic conditions, most of these are run in either at least an equivalent or a very high concentration, or even the entire solvent for the reaction of pyridine, an aromatic base that we see here. It acts as a good solvent and a weak base that is strong enough to absorb a strong acid and prevent it from causing problems in our reactions. And so we'll abbreviate that pyridine as PYR in our reactions below. Okay, so if we're looking at the reactions that form a good nucleophile, we've got to decide, is a good nucleophile or good leaving group, is a good nucleophile produced in situ? So at the same time as the reactions being occurred without us doing anything, in that case, substitution will be favored. And so let's first look at phosphorus trichloride and phosphorus tribromide. We're going to have subsequent SN2 reactions and a deprotonation by pyridine. And if we have a chiral center, we're going to see inversion of that chiral center on a secondary position. Now, we'll look at that in just a moment with thionyl chloride, as the mechanism is very similar. Okay, so we see it works with a primary or secondary alcohol, and we just treat with our reagent in a solvent of pyridine or in a high concentration of pyridine to absorb that extra acid. Well, the mechanism tells us what's going on. So what we're going to see, if we're looking at the mechanism, is an SN2 attack from a lone pair on the alcohol to the phosphorus center. It's got a lone pair, it's a tetrahedral electron geometry, does just fine for an SN2. Now what do we get from that? Well, we end up with a protonated species here that's been converted into a good leaving group. The oxygen now is connected to a PBr2 group, and so now the pyridine jumps in, a very rapid reaction. Nitrogen on pyridine is grabbing our proton, and the lone pair goes back to oxygen. Well, at this point, we have an irreversible step. Remember, we have created an equivalent of bromide, a good nucleophile in this situation, a good leaving group now. And so now we can attack that position here, the primary position or secondary carbon, to get back to our alkyl halide product. With thionyl chloride, we're very similar, except now our reagent is thionyl chloride. Don't forget, it does have a lone pair on the sulfur, and sulfur compounds with this electron geometry tend to act like, in certain situations, that they are almost a fully formed positive charge on sulfur and a negative charge on oxygen, a nucleophilic oxygen and electrophilic sulfur. Okay, so be aware of that. It's a common property of these thionyl type reagents. So anyway, as we're looking at this, again, tetrahedral type center, especially if we're looking at this form. And so what we get in our mechanism is an attack to that sulfur center from a lone pair on the oxygen, kicking off a chloride in an SN2 type reaction. And then what do we see? Well, in the first step here, we have retained configuration of our chiral center that we have on the secondary carbon. Primary or secondary are reactive to thionyl chloride. And now our pyridine swoops in, again, a In this situation, it might as well be a strong base because it so much favors protonation of the pyridine by the pKa values, and we end up with our good leaving group. Again, the chiral center still has its configuration retained here. Now finally, we get our irreversible step where the chloride comes in and attacks SN2 fashion backside attack to invert the configuration of the original chiral center. And we eliminate our stable ionic byproduct that floats off and is either precipitated or decomposed. So we can look actually at that decomposition that occurs. Paying attention to our thionyl here, we could actually see how this forms SO2 and a chloride ion. Okay, so it's entropically favored as well on the inversion. If we're doing this substitution with a tosylate or sulfonyl ester, let's actually look at the structure. So our tosyl chloride here is the chlorinated form of tosic acid, which actually we can show without redrawing the whole structure here. Tosic acid would look like this. So it's a strong acid. It's like sulfuric acid, except it's got a very large nonpolar entity on it that we can manipulate depending on the properties of the reaction that we see. So we'll see a lot of these different sulfonic acids and sulfonyl chlorides where we just change the group that's attached. Okay, but it makes a pretty good leaving group because this is a strong acid with a pKa much less than zero, so the tosylate itself is a good leaving group. All right, so now that we've got our vocabulary all set here, we can do a single SN2 reaction on a primary and secondary alcohol after we've made our tosylate. Now, we can form a stable tosylate with a primary, secondary, or tertiary alcohol. So the scope of this is really pretty large, but to do an SN2 reaction later, we would only be able to do that on a primary or secondary, and we would get inversion of configuration of that nucleophile. We could also do elimination for a secondary or tertiary. If we had a strong base and a poor nucleophile, we would actually favor an E2 type elimination. And for this particular one, we'd get our Zaitsev product as we see here. So a couple things we can do, but the good thing about tosylates is we can isolate these for use later. We can use it as a protecting group for our alcohol. Couple things that we can do. All right, so what's the mechanism here? Well, again, that sulfur has a tetrahedral center, and so we can attack that position kicking off our chloride. And now we have attached, retaining the configuration here, because the carbon's not affected by this SN2. And we've got our tosylate that we can show rather quickly instead as OTS here instead of drawing out the whole structure. So we'll do that. Our pyridine comes in with its lone pair, grabs that acidic proton, and now we have our isolable tosylate, and again we can do SN2 reaction to that or an E2 reaction for secondary or tertiary. Now our next category here is elimination, and so if we're going to form the good leaving group, especially an exceptionally good leaving group like we're going to see, but no good nucleophile we're going to see elimination instead of substitution, and we're going to see pyridine used as the solvent, so it's in highest possible concentration in this reaction with phosphorus oxychloride. We're going to get an E2 mechanism for this. We'll see, and because of that, we'll see no migration of the pi bond. And I wanted to show you this reaction we talked about in the other video, where we do get migration of the pi bond. We initially form it here, and then it migrates over through sequential reactions in hot sulfuric acid. We're in equilibrium, so we can do that until we reach the more stable product that we see on the right-hand side. But with phosphorus oxychloride, we are going to see that we can stop after our first E2 elimination, and we have more control over the product mixture here. So let's look at what happens. So again, we're very familiar at this point what we're dealing with. Show the bond that's going to break here. We're going to see an SN2 onto that phosphorus center, kicking off a leaving group. Still got that proton. We've got our pyridine in solution quickly. Fast acid-base reaction. They're very fast. Deprotonates. Anti-periplanar elimination, our irreversible step, the pyridine, a second equivalent of pyridine comes in to grab our proton here. And we do our final E2 step to get to our exocyclic double bond. And we don't see a sequential reaction to form the more stable, more substituted alkene as we would in acid. If we're doing elimination, remember, we can do this for secondary and tertiary alcohols because of our stability of the tosylate. It's a good leaving group. On this tertiary center, we are not going to see any substitution because SN2 is forbidden at a tertiary center because of sterics. And so instead we see elimination, E2 fashion. We can just draw that proton out. Any one of the protons here will work. And we'll see our base, our strong base, be able to perform that in one step. But remember, the good thing about the tosylate is we can delay when we do this till later in a synthesis in the presence of other functional groups as a protecting group as well. So remember, these reactions are carried out so that they contain an irreversible step. We avoid the complications of rearrangements, expansions, and bond migration to a more stable alkene for elimination reactions. We can retain stereochemistry because of this, and so for both SN2 and E2, we've got to think about SN2, inversion of configuration if a chiral center is our point of attack, and we've also got to think about anti-periplanar elimination for E2 reactions.